Welcome to the BitGeek Podcast. I'm your host, Ron Avis, and sitting with me on the couch to my left is my co-host, the Prince of Pixels,
Nick Wright.
And today we're going to be talking about 15 of our favorite game shows. So, Nick, here we are. It's been a couple weeks since we've had a chance to record. Mm-hmm. And, you know, whenever we get together to record, we have like a little brainstorming sesh on what topic we want to do. And, you know, with this particular topic, it just came to me.
Like, why haven't we done this before?
I know, all right? And we've done like games. We've talked about like numerous different consoles. And sometimes we've double dipped on consoles, it feels like. Mm-hmm. Board games, you name it. So, like, why don't we do a TV game show episode?
It's impossible to do a TV game show without...
It's G.B. Blackrock himself, you may know him as, in the Transformers community, but Mark Baker-Wright.
Hi.
Welcome back, Mark.
Glad to be here.
Yeah, so not only guru of all things Transformers, but guru of all things game shows.
Yes. You know, Mark's a really knowledgeable guy, obviously, but when I think of Mark, those two things come to mind almost immediately. Yeah. He is an aficionado of Transformers and game shows. So it's going to be great to have Mark on board. You know that he's going to bring a lot to the episode. I mean, you and I could talk quite a lot to the game shows, but...
I cannot talk a lot about game shows.
Are you serious? I just assumed it was like one of your big deals.
Oh, no, not at all.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I enjoy some game shows here and there, but that's not exactly a forte.
Gee, I don't know. I have a feeling once we start talking about this stuff, you're going to have a lot to say. I just have a feeling.
When do I have a lot to say anyway?
Well, you say more than you give yourself credit for. But, you know, speaking of game shows, I was having a conversation with Logan earlier, and he likes to ask me, you know, like, oh, what are you guys going to record about, you know, this week? And I was like, we're going to record about something that you have no concept of, actually.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of sad.
I know. But it's not like game shows aren't around anymore, but they're way more, like, they're prime time, you know, they're not the same as they were.
Yeah.
It's kind of a bygone era of TV game shows, and it goes back so far. There's such a rich history of game shows.
Well, I'm dying to know now, though. So what was his face like when you told him what it was?
Blank expression. Like, I feel like, so no, but I attempted to explain it. I was like, okay, we're doing, you know, it's called a game show, and my like quick explanation trying to explain to a seven-year-old, I'm like, okay, you know, you have two teams. Sometimes it's one versus one, and oftentimes there's some trivia, you'll answer a question, and then there's some sort of, you know, thing, you know, like I just didn't know how to explain it exactly. Yeah. And, you know, based on how many points or dollars, whoever has the most, then there's this elevated thing, you know, like of that game. You know, it's just an elevated version of that game with higher stakes.
He needed Mark to explain what a
game I did. I'm going to show this. I'm going to show this to Logan. And like when Mark starts talking about game shows, I'm just going to turn it to him. let Uncle Mark explain it a little better. Mark, when you think about game shows.
I can totally give you history, but I don't know how much that's fully, you know, within the purview of what we're talking about.
If you were explaining a game show to a seven-year-old, how would you do it?
Well, if he plays board games, for example, there are board games that have been turned into television shows. Or you can do one of the earliest shows was Beat the Clock, where you do youth group type stuff.
You lost Logan. He's completely lost.
Can you do this weird thing in 60 seconds or less?
Right. Okay, now you got his attention again.
I'd probably say something like, you know, there's a show on TV where you have like a number of contestants,
yeah,
often three, but not, you know, I mean, it can be like whatever number.
Oh, yeah.
You know, to win prizes, you know, and they got to do like, you know, whether it's answering trivia questions or, you know, whatever the game is, but
right.
To win prizes.
Yeah, there's a theme usually, and then they tailor the show usually around the theme. Whether the team... Or not the theme. The theme could be something really simple, like a childhood game that we've all played, and it could, or it could be like a really high concept game. But that's the beauty of game shows, is, I mean, it could be any number of different things. Mm-hmm. But,
well, yeah, and there's actually some debate depending on what type of show you're talking about. Does this count? I'm not going to get into that too much here because we can talk about that as we actually start listing shows.
Yeah, because I think some of mine the might fall.
The definition
into that
is
category.
Not necessarily set in stone, other than there's a game element to it, and it's a show.
That's
it's
right.
A game show.
If you want to break it down to its, you know, like fundamental, like it's a game show. And yeah, because when we were discussing all three of us, like I had one in particular, I was like, does this count? I don't even know. It's. And then, you know, Mark was like, yeah, that absolutely counts in my mind, mm-hmm. in his mind, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And I'm biased, too. There are shows that someone might try to say is a game show that I don't think count. But again, we can get into that as we get into the list. We need to.
Yeah, absolutely. I would like to hear some of, like, you know, shows that Mark would not allow to be on the list that he might argue against. But now
I could argue against. I'm not sure I would say I won't allow, because this is where, again, people have different opinions. And depending on what they're talking about, I wouldn't actually disagree that it's valid. I just would disagree that I wouldn't consider it a game show.
Right. Someone's opinion is their opinion. You're not going to convince them otherwise. You might convince them that, oh, like, well, I guess it wasn't a show. But I mean, that would be sad if you tried to do that.
I'm not a fan of the idea that all opinions are equal, because opinions are based on stuff. And, you know, that basis may be something that is reliable, or it may be something that's really flimsy.
Yeah.
And so you can convince someone that their opinion is wrong, but I don't want to start getting into saying that an opinion, because it's an opinion, you know, is something that is invalid. I need to get to what the basis of the opinion is.
Yeah, the way I always looked at it is, you know, people would say you have to respect everyone's opinion. I'm like, no, I don't have to respect your opinion. I will acknowledge your opinion, but I don't have to respect your opinion. Yeah. That's kind of the way I look at it.
Mm-hmm.
But that aside, and we've all kind of each, all three of us gave our elevator quick, you know, pitch to a 7-year-old what a game show is. I kind of like that concept. We may have to use that again sometime. Like, pitch it to a 7-year-old. How would you explain it to them?
I like it.
Yeah. So we'll just get down to the nitty gritty. I do believe that this will probably end up being a 2-part episode due to the number of shows we're going to mention. Also, I'd also like to say at the top of the show, these are just 15 of our favorite shows. These are not the 15 best shows in our opinion.
Oh, yeah. I mean, because there's absolutely some that we left out that just because they're like so mainstream. Mm-hmm. That, I mean, it's kind of like when we leave out Transformers. And,
yeah.
You know, that it's like, well, we've already talked about that, so. Everybody knows about that.
Right. Yeah. It, when we get to 15 and you go, well, what about this show? This is obviously one of the greatest shows ever. It's like, you're right. But maybe we'll save that show for another episode, because I think we could get a few shows out of this topic.
Yeah, and because like these are absolutely not like ranked.
No.
Absolutely not. It's just like we just decided, hey, we like these.
My list, these are 5 shows I found very fun and I enjoyed them. And a bit of it's nostalgia based too. Like there are shows that may not be on this list that are still running. Most of mine are not running, and I just have this nostalgia for them, and I want to talk about those shows. Mm-hmm. So just to, like, you know, like I said, that's a disclaimer up top. You know, these aren't ranked. These are just 15 shows that we really like. They're 15 of our favorite game shows. So what I like to do is, if we have a guest on the show, I like to let them go first. So we're each going to have 5, and we'll kind of alternate between the 5 of the 3 of us until we have 15 total. So without further ado, our guest, Mark Baker-Wright, is going to lead us off with his first game show.
All right. I wanted to start off with a show that most people, if you know game shows at all, you're going to know this one, and it's Pyramid.
From Television City in Hollywood, this is the new $25,000 Pyramid. Today's special guests from Mama's Family, Betty White and Subi Sale. And here is your host, Dick Hart.
Wow. Thank you very, very much. Welcome to the new $25,000 Pyramid.
Now, you probably don't know it as Pyramid. You probably know it as the $100,000 pyramid or the $25,000 pyramid or the $10,000 pyramid. It was also $20,000 and $50,000 at some point or another.
The increment of money always changes.
That's exactly what I was going to ask him, is like, which increment of money is the one that you're going to say?
I tried to deal with that right up front.
Mark, for me, it's $25,000. I'm sorry, Mark. Go ahead. I'm sorry. This is your pick.
That's fine. The one that I grew up with was the new $25,000 pyramid. Okay. That is to say, it had been $25,000 earlier in its lifetime, and I was too young to notice. And then it came back on CBS, and it was on daytime for a good long while. And they actually did drop new from the title after it had been on for a few more years. But the second version of the $25,000 pyramid, when it was that number, is the one I really knew growing up.
I don't even really remember it saying new.
It's weird that they would say the new. It's kind of like new Super Mario Brothers, you know, like they just throw that up.
I mean, that's in the title.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to take the moment now to bring out my,
oh my God,
bit He's of extra help.
I've never seen
the
this
Encyclopedia
before.
Of TV Game Shows. This is a book that my Grandma Evie, found for me. And in any discussion about game shows, you have to talk about Grandma Evie. And because she was a contestant on a game show back just after I'd been born.
And won a car.
No
she
way.
Was a five-time undefeated champion on a show called Split Second. Their big prize there was, in fact, a car. Grandma never got her driver's license.
Yeah, she doesn't drive.
Well, didn't you also have to pay all of the taxes on the vehicle? Like,
well, yes, actually you do. It. Any kind of prizes you win, you still have to pay that as if it were income. Yeah. So that's added to your taxes.
What year was this?
This would be 75.
Was it a Gremlin?
No, as a matter of fact, it was a Chevy, I want to say Camaro.
Ooh, that would have been one of the first ones? No, the 60s maybe was the first, in the 60s.
Well, now, this is getting off field. It's not about Pyramid, but since Split Second isn't one of our shows that any of us are likely to talk about, because it's right. All but forgotten today, the bonus game for this was basically you got a key and there were five cars. And if this was your first time as champion, you could try that key in one of those cars. And if it started, you won that car. Familiar,
actually.
Now, they did something very much like this on one of the versions of another show later on.
I think
on,
other shows have done this.
Okay.
You've likely never seen this show.
Okay.
Yeah, so we'll deal with that later. Anyway, at the end of 5 days, Grandma still had not been able to start the car. And what they did, if you actually won all five, you know, they'd eliminate a car each day so that you'd have a better chance. Hmm. But at the end of five, if you still hadn't won, you would get to pick which one of those five cars you wanted. Oh. And that was automatically yours.
Nice. So it was five different cars. And I guess I assume you would
Grandma
want to.
Won.
Yeah. Were
after
they?
Grandma won, Aunt Wendy came on stage. This is my mom's older sister. And Aunt Wendy is actually the one who chose the car, because Aunt Wendy was responsible for getting Grandma on the show in the first place. She convinced Grandma to sign the little postcard or whatever it is, send it in to go down to Southern California, audition for the show. So Aunt Wendy is the one that actually got to choose the car.
Were the cars all like similar in value, or do they have like luxury cars that people would go for first?
They're broadly the same
In
terms of basic value.
But she did get to pick the one she wanted because she survived the five times, right?
Exactly.
Nice. That's really cool. And so Wendy chose the Camaro.
That's my understanding.
Okay. Not bad. I mean, I might have too. I don't know what the others were, but the Camaro's pretty cool.
Nah. The sorry thing about all this is Split Second, like a lot of shows of the 80s and earlier, those tapes don't exist anymore. You cannot watch them. There are maybe a half dozen episodes that are in circulation that someone video recorded or managed to save.
Mm-hmm.
But the episodes my grandma was in, video does not exist this anymore. So I've never seen them. I've heard audio of them because grandma did a tape recorder that she would put right next to the TV and she'd record them that way. But I've never actually seen these episodes.
So it would be impossible then? Like, there's no one that anyone could go to and speak with to try and find these videotapes?
unless there are copies that have been in private private holdings that no one's told anyone about, then there's no way. But the networks themselves destroyed the copies because
they didn't have space for them.
This was an era where that would take up space and they could use that material for other things.
That's really sad. A lot of really old movies, faced a demise similar to that. Like really old movies, they had to destroy them. They weren't saved. That's a really interesting story. Thanks for sharing that, Mark. That's really cool. So you actually are related to a grand prize winner of a game show.
Yeah.
And do you think maybe that is one of the reasons why you love game shows so much?
Oh, absolutely. I come by it honestly, I tell folks. Anyway, going back to Pyramid, because that's what we're really supposed to be talking about.
I love Pyramid.
Pyramid started in 73. And so it had been through a number of incarnations. By the time the version I knew came on, it was already 1982. And it didn't stay, quote-unquote, new $25,000 Pyramid for very long. And this is perhaps, Nick, why you don't remember, because you were still quite young in 82. And it maybe it was only a year or two before they stopped calling it new and just said it's the $25,000 Pyramid again.
Right, okay.
When did Dick Clark host that show in its entire run, or were there multiple hosts?
Because
a lot of shows had multiple game show hosts.
Dick Clark hosted every version of Pyramid from its beginning till about 89, except for the original $25,000 Pyramid. Sorry about that. Okay. The original $25,000 Pyramid was actually hosted by Bill Cullen.
Okay. That's a name that some people are probably familiar with.
Bill Cullen, if you know game shows, you know Bill Cullen, because he hosts more game shows than anyone else in history.
Yeah. You were actually telling me, I think, that this is one of the shows that has been revived, kind of? Like, it's a current...
It has. ABC has a current version. It is the $100,000 Pyramid. Michael Strahan, who was a football player, he's on Good Morning America now, is the host of that.
I know who Michael Strahan is. That's just why it blew my mind that he was the host.
He's very good.
He's not bad. So I will have to check that out. I mean, I remember when you told me that, like, my mind was blown. It's like, what? No, I've never heard of this before.
Now, let me ask you this, though. Since 25 is the one that you remember most from your, youth, when did it become the $100,000 Pyramid?
Well, again, depends on how you ask the question.
Well, I ask
when
you this.
$5,000 Pyramid was popular. That was on CBS, the network. Mm-hmm. About a year or two into that, they started doing the $100,000 version in syndication. So it was a nighttime version. And basically, the $100,000 Pyramid at that time was played exactly the same as the $25,000 version, with a couple of exceptions. At the winner's circle, if you made it to the top and won that prize, you're going to be the fastest. You're trying to be the fastest time in that. And after about a month or so, the top three times would come and play again as a tournament. And the first person to get to the top of the pyramid successfully in the winner's circle of that tournament would win $100,000. But otherwise, prize structures were the same. $10,000 for the first time, $25,000 if you made it twice in the same show. Which wasn't the structure for the previous $25,000 pyramid, I should say. That was the CBS version.
I ask you that because I dug up some of your old, IBM, DOS, computer versions of some of these game shows. And it was the $100,000 at this time, which this says 1987 on it. So that's the only reason I kind of wondered if you can put it.
Which was still Dick Clark's era. There was another $100,000 pyramid almost immediately after Dick Clark stopped doing it, maybe a year after. There was another version of the $100,000 pyramid came on with John Davidson. And it was played mostly the same, but they did tweak the rules a bit that time. And that didn't last terribly long. It went off the air. There have been a couple other versions of pyramid that have shown up in the years since, usually not doing a dollar number for the name, and the prize payouts are different for various reasons. The $100,000 with Michael Strahan came back in 2016.
So we've spent a bit of time, talking about the different eras, but somebody out there may not even have actually seen the show. Mark, can you kind of briefly explain like what an episode or what a show typically, you know, how it was structured?
Sure. This is essentially a word game. I give you at the front game one of six categories. You choose one, and then I tell you to describe for your partner these things that fit within that certain list. The timer starts, and you see one word at a time, and you can use hand gestures, you can describe in any way you like, except you can't use the word itself.
Right.
Now, if that happened, a very familiar cuckoo sound would hear, and you'd have to forfeit that word and go on to the next one.
And the viewer was able to see the word, so that was always enjoyable.
You're trying to get as many of seven words that were the maximum possible in 30 seconds. This would be played for three rounds each of two teams, so six total. And whoever had the high score at that would move on to the winner's circle. Mm-hmm. If you got to the winner's circle, the game was kind of flipped around. Instead, they would give you a category, and you would try to describe a list rather than long, lengthy verbal statements. So prepositional phrases, for example, were an instant disqualifier. Mm-hmm. But you would say, for, say, the category, things you would see in a circus, a clown, the ringmaster, mm-hmm. and you'd go off
then
on a
you
list
would say, things you see in a circus.
Until someone said, see things you see in a circus, and right. then you get the dollar amount for that particular part of the pyramid, move on to the next one, and if you get all six items that are part of the pyramid, you would win the top prize, $10,000, $25,000, whatever it is for that particular show.
Okay, so you can only say, like, a word for your clue.
Now, there are a couple of exceptions that are very common in the winner's circle. One category, for example, would be things a such-and-such might say. So if it were things a Transformer might say, well, my name is Optimus Prime, and I lead the Autobots in the fight against the Decepticons. I have lots of my friends. And until someone said things a Transformer might say, you could just keep rambling on.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So... This leads me to one of my favorite things about the show, honestly. If they're doing the final center area, the pyramid, the winner's circle, thank you, and the contestants fail, here come Dick Clark itching to play. Like, he had to give his version of, you know, the clue.
Fall on the ground, things that drop.
Glass.
Things that break. Things that
airplanes.
The 1929 yes. stock market.
Is it crash?
Yes. Sure, I love it when you come in and give the absolute perfect answer. Don't you love that?
No host I could ever think of seemed to want to play his own show more than Dick Clark wanted to play Pyramid.
I don't remember.
You don't remember
so
that?
I'm familiar with it. He would always have like this key word that if only someone had thought to say it, yes. that would have absolutely made the connection.
Like, you he did it every time.
All you had to do was just say this.
It's like, you know everything. You've had time to think of your keyword, probably, or maybe not. But
and of course, he's not stressed out.
No, he's calmly thinking, right. I just love that about the show. He would come sauntering over and he'd put like one leg up, like, you know, like casually. One of my other favorite aspects of Pyramid is they would often enlist celebrities to match up with the contestants.
Absolutely. It's a celebrity show.
Yeah.
Always play two celebrities for every day. Mm-hmm. Each team gets one celebrity and it's a partnering kind of a game. This also means that if you're saddled with a really stupid celebrity, you have no chance of winning.
Like on Friends, Joey was one of the celebrities.
Ready? Go. Okay, it's a store like a supermarket. Oh, I see what I did there. Okay. I'm writing in my diary. No, more like a notebook.
Damn it. Oh, no. I can imagine how that went. Well, I was watching one time and Tony Danza was on, and I was like, oh, gosh, this is probably not going to go well. But he actually did really well.
So. He's actually pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, Tony Danza's pretty good.
That Friends episode was during Donny Osmond's version of the pyramid.
What? Was there an actual Donny Osmond pyramid?
Yep, for 2 years in syndication. That was just called Pyramid. Mm-hmm. Again, no number attached to it.
Nice.
So you had given me a list of seven such words. Am I supposed
All right, I'm going to start with Ron, actually.
Oh, we're going to do this? We're going to play the game
we're
now?
We're going to do this.
Okay.
Oh, man, I got to guess?
Yep.
Well, we're each going to have a turn.
Ron is going to describe for you, and I'll tell folks, I picked this up from the home game.
Oh, man.
Ron, you are going to describe for Nick, the category I'm choosing, I should tell you, actually, is He Stole My Heart. And Ron, you're going to describe for Nick, words in a column for the Lovelorn. That's words in a column for the Lovelorn.
Okay, ready? So am I just going to start with one and then go 1 to 7?
That's right. Just stay with one until Nick says it. And if he does, I'll tell you it's correct.
And I can pass, right?
And if Nick's getting hung up, you can't get it passed, just tell me you're passing so I won't be looking at the wrong word.
Man, I'm no good at this.
Okay.
At the end of 30 seconds, you will hear the buzzer.
All right.
Ready? Go.
Okay. So you, on your face, if you're smiling, this is how you're feeling?
Happy.
Yes.
Okay.
I got one right.
Yeah. Okay. If you're having an affair and you're a man, then the other person would be called your.
My mind went blank.
Okay. Pass.
Okay.
Okay. If you're not playing fair, you're
cheating.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. A member of your family would also be called.
You get the buzzer?
Yeah. Oh, I can't say
No, no, the buzzer is simply because time ran out.
Oh, no, okay, oh, wow.
That was 30 seconds.
I suck.
That is a fast 30 seconds.
Points.
Ooh, okay, the first one you couldn't think of was Mistress.
That's right.
Oh, okay.
Ooh, oh, man.
And Ron was just beginning to describe a relative.
Oh, I thought you buzzed me for, you know, like, I can't say.
You were fine, you were perfectly fine. Oh, okay. This was a time ran out.
Wow.
And once I hit the start, I actually don't pay attention to the timer again until it goes.
I've watched Pyramids so many times. Like, I don't think I've ever felt like that kind of pressure. Like, you know, that 30 seconds flew by.
Man, I'm scared.
Okay, all right.
So, well,
all right, Nick,
I'm still
kind
of confused, though. So, but do I just say, like, a word? Or can I say, like, a phrase?
You can do anything you want except say the word you're trying to get Ron to say.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
The category is called Make It Last. Nick, please describe for Ron these things that are preserved. Things that are preserved. Ready? Go.
Okay, you can spread this on bread, strawberry.
Jam.
Yes.
An elephant has...
Tusk.
Yes.
A wedding...
Ring. Dress. Gown.
Yeah.
Yes.
A dinosaur
fossil.
Yes.
Link from Zelda always
carries the sword.
Well, he hits these and breaks these.
Trees of grass. No.
pass.
Man, you use Zelda. I'm heartbroken.
I would have got this next
one
too.
You got 4 correct, so definitely did better. That one Nick was trying to get you to say was pottery.
That was like the only way I could think.
Oh, well, yeah, that's a good clue. I can't argue with that clue. That was fun. We should have done more. All right.
Well, suffice it to say, getting it set up so that you even had clues over the distance, since I'm in California and you guys are in Kentucky, that was the real challenge.
Yeah, that's true.
I should have passed on pottery right away because I really wanted you to get this one. I was going to say...
Well, just for fun, go ahead and describe.
For fun, go for it.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, Steve Martin, King...
Tut.
Absolutely perfect.
So that was really fun, and that's just a little taste of what, you know, Pyramid was all about. See, Nick, you did really good. You were all concerned that wouldn't do well.
Well, I was concerned when I had to guess for myself, because I was kind of okay with giving
Nick
clues.
That was happening.
Yeah. That's cool, Mark. Thanks for setting that up, buddy.
I just kind of figured we'll just do, like, the one-sided thing just to show a taste of it. Like,
oh, no, whoop. No. I was in sync with Mark. I wanted us to each get to do it, you know? So that's really fun, and that's a great show to kick things off. Number one,
yeah.
Pyramid. Mark, do you have anything else interesting that you would like to share about Pyramid, or should we just let the game end and speak for itself?
I think at this point it speaks for itself, and we've gone longer on this than I imagine we will for most of the others. But Pyramid is one of the all-time classics. Especially with this current version where they have been so faithful. They didn't monkey around with stuff that didn't need changing. Because a lot of these classic shows, you change the formula too much, and it just fails. Some you need to change because it's a product of its time,
right.
And we'll perhaps get into that too.
Yeah.
But Pyramid really works in its current version. So if you can catch the ABC version, it's not on continually every week. They do it in little short spurts, often in the summertime. But get the chance, definitely watch it.
The really good game shows are simple. You know, like they're just easy to, you know, and you can adapt
absolutely.
To the times. You're more or less playing charades, except, you know, like you're giving clues to a person one-on-one, and it's an easy game to play. And I don't know if you guys did this, but my brother and I used to, like, when we would watch Pyramid, we would kind of turn our backs. One of us would turn our backs towards the television.
Sure.
And, you know, we would listen to the clues being given, and we would try to guess.
Yeah, and try to guess on your own.
Yeah. So that it was a game that you could kind of play on your own, like, you know, while watching the show. And,
yeah. Just cover up the thing on the screen, and you can do it just fine.
It's always easier than or harder than it looks.
Well, it's what I think a lot of people, I mean, you kind of alluded to this earlier when you're talking about Dick Clark, you know, not being like on the spot and everything. It's like you're sitting there watching at home and you guess these things and you're like, oh, you're an idiot. You know,
I know. Yeah. Like, oh my God, I can't believe
I love berating contestants.
I mean, cause that's how I am. Like when I'm just like the casual observer,
yeah,
then I have no problem at all. When I'm putting on the spot, I just lock up.
Oh yeah. And how did we do, Mark? Nick guessed how many.
Ron got Nick to say two of your list, and Nick got Ron to say four of his.
Okay. All right. Well played, sir. Or not.
I was trying to decide, like, so what's that make me? Is that good or is that bad? I'm good at dishing.
It's a
out.
Know your audience kind of game, too. Like, you have to try and give clues to, like, what you were trying to do, and I was just. That you break these, I'm like grass. Like, why would I say grass?
what was that Odd Couple thing that they were on Pyramid?
They were on Password.
Oh, Password. Oh, okay.
All right, so we'll go ahead and move on to the next show, which Nick, I'll let you choose your first show.
Okay, yeah. So for my first show, I'm gonna say Name That Tune. Mark can probably talk circles around me about the game. I mean, because like I kind of said earlier, you know, I mean, there's some games I watched and I enjoyed and whatever, but I don't have much to say about them. But Name That Tune stands out as one, like when I was a kid, that it was just fun to just, you know, they would be like, I can name that tune in one note.
Oh my God.
And you know, they'd give some kind of a clue.
Yeah.
You know, so you weren't just going in blind and you just bonk and you know, just say that.
Right.
You
right.
Know, so they,
now, Nick.
Yeah.
You, I'm guessing, remember the Jim Lang version most.
I have no idea who the host
I don't remember the hosts.
The two people who were hosts while we were alive were Tom Kennedy and Jim Lang. Now, Tom Kennedy, I have affection for because he was the host of the show that Grandma was on.
So I mean, and really, you know, and I wouldn't even know also because I think a lot of times I just saw reruns, you know, that I would see just old shows. First,
every show I ever saw, I'm sure, was some sort of syndicated rerun.
Yeah, so I have no idea, like, what era, you know, I might have been seeing. But it was just a lot of fun, though, just trying to guess. You know, they would play just a couple of notes and people guessing these songs.
Marty, are you able to pull up like when that show aired, like the dates?
Is that
what
I can.
Pardon?
Got the book.
Yeah. He's got the book.
He's got the book.
The first show first premiered in 1953.
Whoa. Wow.
This show's got a lot of history to it. Most commonly known host of that version is a guy named George DeWitt. I know nothing about him.
I've heard of the name.
Two of the other hosts of that era are guys named Red Benson. Again, never heard of him. And Bill Cullen, who I do know about, because again, he hosted everything. That version lasted for a good number of years. Looks like to 59, so about 7 years, it looks like. Mm-hmm. Then I mentioned Tom Kennedy already. He came on for the 1974 to 81 version, which it looks like Dennis James also hosted. I know his name, but he's not somebody I'm familiar with. And then it was off the air for a few years, came back for a short time, 84 to 85. That was the Jim Lang version, which did get repeated a lot. So that's the one I'm thinking you're most likely to remember, Nick.
Okay. I'll take your word for it.
Now, in my mind's eye, I'm picturing, or I'm trying to remember how, like, because sometimes, like, the sets of game shows were impressive and fun to look at. And I want to say, like, was it a big clock that they were looking at? Like, or was it something that was just presented on the screen?
Sure. Like, well, name that tune, I don't even remember a set other than, like, a piano tune sitting there.
Yeah, I'll try to describe as best I can and recognize, of course, that different versions did different things.
Yeah.
This is one of those, again, the concept is right there in the title. And the way they did this was through a series of different, we'll call them parlor games. And they weren't always the same throughout a run. They would sometimes change things up. For the runs that I remember, the first segment was always called Melody Roulette, at which point they had a large wheel filled with dollar amounts. Uh-huh. Spin the wheel, whatever dollar amount would be how much you would win if you correctly named the tune. So musician would start playing, you'd think you know what it is, you buzz in, you tell them the name of the tune, you win that amount of money.
Mm-hmm.
Other parts of the game often had extra gimmicks on it. So there is a bid a note, which is one of the more well known. The host would read a clue
talking about
that would basically describe the tune. And if you thought that clue could only mean this particular song,
yeah,
you might actually tell the person.
Do it in one note.
Exactly.
Here's the next one. This song was the first Beatle release on Apple Records, and Paul McCartney was the featured singer. This time you start the bidding, Wash.
Sandy? You name that tune in four notes.
Wash, I can name that tune in one note.
Oh.
Or if you're less confident, but you think that, you know, just a little bit will help you figure it out, I can name that tune in four notes.
So well, you were bidding, you were putting up a certain amount of your own winnings at that point?
No, that's later.
Okay, okay.
But mostly you're trying to win enough games to move on to the bonus round, and I'll talk about that later. But for a bit of note, it's usually the one that they did towards the end of a show that wasn't the bonus round.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, once you got, you alternated back and forth, I can name that tune in five notes, I can name that tune in four notes. Once it's down low enough that you don't think the other person really can, you would then say, name that tune.
Here is your one note.
Michelle.
Ooh, I'm sorry. Hey, Jude! Hey, Jude! Was the first song on Beatles or on the Apple?
They play those four notes.
Oh, see, I forgot.
Give you a chance to play.
You were like back and forth with somebody else. Like, they're like, well, I can do it in five notes. Oh, yeah? Well, I can do it in four notes.
Yeah, well, that's the exciting part,
off
though.
Of the clue that was read beforehand and hoping that clue is actually giving you most of the information.
Right. And then when the guy would be like, or the girl, whoever, I can name that tune in one note, everybody's like, oh!
That was like the you've been served kind of moment of the show.
So whoever won the most games and had the highest score at the end of the regular play would go on to play the Golden Medley. And so that's where the big clock comes in.
Okay, okay. So there was a big clock. Okay.
There is a big clock. I think it's 60 seconds.
Yeah.
I'm actually trying to look this up while talking, as it were.
Seven songs in 30. And it would, you know, kind of go and it would stop if they named it, and then it would continue. Like, I don't really remember that kind of clock.
Yeah. So there's seven songs, and they're going to start playing them one by one.
Mm.
And you think you know, you buzz in, you stop the clock, you name the tune, and if you're right, great. If not, you got to keep going. So what if you really don't feel like you know the song, you can pass.
Okay.
Now, actually, I'm trying to remember. Yes. I had to look this up. I didn't remember it right. If you guessed it wrong, uh-huh, the game's over.
Ooh, so that's the penalty. That's what I was wanting to know. If you guessed it wrong,
you don't. You can only win the gold medley and the bonus prize if you get all seven songs right. Now you do have the opportunity to pass.
Mm. So how many can you pass on?
You're not as familiar with, and shelve it and come back to it if there's time left on the clock after you've gotten the others.
Now, were these usually like show tunes, or were they like, you know?
They could be.
Yeah, like I'm trying to remember the were they popular songs ever? Like, you know, like pop rate, like what was pop contemporary songs?
They have to be songs that are, we'll just say, expected to be in the pop, in the common culture.
Okay.
So maybe something you hear on the radio. Okay. Maybe something part of a musical.
So like Beethoven's symphony, like, you know, like one, like maybe not. Well, some of those you would know, I guess.
If it's well known enough,
yeah.
It's fair game.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But they're not going to do something that is expected to be obscure.
Okay. Yeah, I remember that show and liking it. And we were kind of listing off shows. I jotted that one down because I enjoyed it. I wasn't good at it, but I did enjoy it. And I think it was just because of that back and forth, the bidding and the one-upping each other, and then having to try and potentially name it in one note. And that happened. Would be able to do it.
Oh, quite often.
Yeah, so that was fun. That was that's a good memory. And it's one of those bygone shows. Like, that show could be recreated today, but why not? I mean...
And well, it has been a couple of times over the years. There was a Name That Video version on MTV sometime back.
I would have loved that. I don't remember that.
But it has video really in one second. Seen the light in a number of years now.
Right. Cool. And Nick, got anything else that you can think about? Let's name that tune.
No.
It's a classic game show. All right, I guess we'll move on to my first one.
Yep.
Okay, my first one is one that I remember playing a lot in elementary school and getting in trouble for doing it. Like, I wasn't supposed to. Well, just not that it was like a bad game necessarily, but it involved playing cards, and I'm talking about Card Sharks.
Ace is high. Deuce is low. Call it right. And win the dough on Card Sharks. And here's the host of Card Sharks, Jim Perry.
Isn't that nice? Thank you.
Oh, man, you know what I remember most about Card Sharks?
What's that?
Go for it.
Big cards.
They're love like those big cards.
Big cards.
Yeah, they turn that, flip that card over, that big old card, and then, you know, didn't they have an opportunity to change the card if they wanted to?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, but Card Sharks is such a simple game. It's just, all you're doing is laying out some cards, and then you get so many cards in the deck, and, you know, they flip a card on the big board, and you know, you would have to go high or low.
Yeah, like, because I remember there's like a little slider thing, like there were cards that were like up on the wall, and there's like a slider that I don't really remember why. I guess it was like
the high or low
thing.
Oh, Mark knows.
Yeah, Mark knows.
Two players. You start off by asking a question that was asked to 100 people, usually something about human nature. We asked 100 people, if this kind of thing happened, would you respond by saying this? How many of those people said yes? And so then the first person who's asked the question has to come up with a number between 1 and 100. And the other person says whether they think that the actual number of respondents was higher or lower than that.
Right.
Whoever wins that question gets the first crack of the board. And the board is consisted of 5 cards strung out in a row.
Mm-hmm.
They flip the first one over.
Mm-hmm.
Because you won the question, you will have the chance to change that card if you don't like it. Aces are high, deuces are low.
Right.
You say whether you think the next one's higher or lower. So let's say it started out with an ace. Liked it, so you can change it.
Yeah.
You say lower.
Right.
And then you get an 8. And 8 is right smack in the middle.
Yep.
Now you can decide whether you want to take your chances and say higher or lower on the next card, because the first one to get all 5 turned over successfully wins the game, or at least that part of the match. Or you can decide to freeze because you don't think you can get the next one right.
Mm-hmm.
That's where that slider comes across.
Yeah.
It protects your position and it keeps the other player from having a chance at their cards. Because if you call a card incorrectly, then you lose everything up to where that slider is sitting.
Yeah.
And the other person then gets a chance to play off of their cards. With the caveat that they do not get to change whatever card shows up on their row because they did not win the question.
That's perfectly described how that works. Now, I don't remember like whether or not there was like a bonus round. Like, what was
there was?
How did the bonus round work, Mark? Please describe it.
Best two out of three match. The third one being a shorter one with only three cards instead of five. Whoever wins two out of those three goes on to what's called the money cards, and that is more of a grid: three cards in the first row, three cards in the second row, and a single card in the top row.
Oh, that's right. And they would have to climb. Yeah.
You start out with $200 with the card just before those three on the first row. Bid any number amount of that from $50 on up to whatever your total is to whether the next card will be higher or lower. If you get it right, you add that. If you get it wrong, you lose that amount. Mm-hmm. After the first row, you move up to the second row and get an additional $200, at least in the original Jim Perry run. It was higher in other versions. And you play three more cards. Then after you finished all those, you get up to the top row, which is what's called the big bet. At that point, you have to bid at least half of whatever you've accumulated to that point. If you got everything right all the way across the board, you'd win well over $20,000.
Mm. Nice. Now, you'd mentioned Jim Perry. He was the original host, right? And from the 70s into the early, I guess, 80s?
Late 70s, early 80s.
Yeah, and that set was awesome. I loved that set. Like, it had, like, giant cards, like, with, like, I remember them being, like, lit up, kind of.
Yeah.
And, you know, the board. I think I remember that board the most out of all the boards. But I was looking at future hosts, but, you know, was it Bob Woolery? Bob Eubanks was a host. Like, I'm like... Do I remember the Bob Eubanks show the most?
That one was on CBS a few years later.
And it was in the 80s, mid-80s, I want to say, mid-86.
Late 80s. I think it might have made it to the early 90s.
Yeah, so that's probably the one I watched the most. But Jim's version I probably saw in reruns. That's the way I'm thinking of it in my head.
And it's on Buzzer. So is the Eubanks version.
Yeah.
Bill Rafferty also hosted a version that was contemporary with the Bob Eubanks version on syndication.
I
never saw that until it was on reruns on Buzzer.
Gotcha. Now, what is Buzzer? I've never heard of that. I've heard of Game Show Network.
You need to know about Buzzer.
Ooh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Lay it on me, man.
ZZR. It is a broadcast network that, since the advent of digital television, you know how most channels, instead of just being channel 13, it'll be a 13.1, 13.2, that kind of thing?
Yeah.
Buzzer operates on those alternative decimal points. So in my area, it's 13.2.
Well, I have DirecTV, and I think there's
another... It's on DirecTV, too.
Okay.
But suffice it to say, anyone can get this because it's through broadcast television. You can get it with your antenna.
Okay.
You just have to look up what number it is for your area.
I'll have to check that out.
Is all game shows owned by Fremantle Media, which has the Mark Goodsman, Bill Todman library, and a number of other shows. But basically, if they don't own it, it's not going to be there. It's not just game shows. It's their holdings. It's stuff they own.
Gotcha. You know, in school, like before classes, you know, I could bring in a deck of cards and we play card sharks. And I was the grid. I'm glad you refreshed my memory on that. I was thinking in my head, like, was there a level that you would go up, or am I just... Is that just something we made up to make the game longer? I couldn't remember. Because it is really a simple game.
And,
you know, if you're just playing it with a friend at school, there's no drama. So, like, you do it fast, you know? Like, and there's no trivia either. You just kind of do it.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, that's one of my old, all-time favorite classic TV shows.
I should mention, for the sake of completion, there was a revival of Card Sharks around 2000 or so. It was terrible. It changed everything that made the show work.
Is that the Pat Bullard version or whatever?
It is that version. I will not dignify it by saying more.
Wow. He's going like Michael Bay kind of company on that one. He sullied the good name of Card Sharks. And that was in the early 2000s for my research. I don't remember
that
it
is
at
correct.
All.
It didn't last very long at all because it was terrible.
I wish they would bring it back. Now, it doesn't necessarily seem like the kind of show they could bring back, but there's another show that one of us has on our list that I'm not going to spoil. It's back now in the weirdest way. So, you know, there's a chance Card Sharks could come back someday. You never know. And with all these channels and networks dedicated to just game shows. Who knows? And I had forgotten about the surveyed thing. Now, that is a long-standing tradition in game shows, too. Like, we surveyed 100 people. I'm like, are these the same 100 people all the time? Yeah. Do they actually take, like, go to a mall or something and do it? I always Sometimes. Wondered how they'd survey people like that.
I don't know why this is, but, like, the picture in my head is, like, knocking on doors, which I know it's not, but it's like they just walk through a neighborhood.
Vacuum cleaner slash survey guy. That's a great visual. I'm going to stick with that. I'm going to say that that's how it worked. Okay, Mark, we're swinging our way back around to you, sir.
All right, my second one is Blockbusters.
This is the battlefield for our game of speed and strategy. These are the letters which lead to victory. On Blockbusters! And here's the star of Blockbusters, Bill.
Thank you. Hello. Hi. Hi there, players.
Blockbusters is a quiz show that was played on a board full of hexagons.
Yeah, I remember that visual.
Five hexagons across, four straight up and down, all interlocking, each one having a different letter of the alphabet in it. The basic idea is you have a team of two players that would be trying to connect hexagons from left to right. The fastest way you can do that would be five. Or a single player playing against the two, that person would be trying to connect from top to bottom, could do that in four. The idea, the gimmick, if you will, was trying to find out if two heads really are better than one.
Oh, okay.
A person would select one of the hexagons by calling out its number.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Mark. Was it always two versus one?
No.
Okay.
I'll get to that later.
Okay.
But the original concept was two versus one. The person in control, or at the start of a game, the host, picks one of the hexagons by calling out its letter. Let's say it's the letter B. They read a question. What B is the Volkswagen Beetle Autobot of the Transformers? Buzz in and say Bumblebee.
Right.
And if you're correct, you get that, and it changes to your color. So the solo player played red, the family pair usually played white, and you're trying to move across the board. The hexagon board is set up in such a way it is not possible to end a game and fill up all those hexagons without somebody winning, either getting top to bottom all the way across or left to right all the way across.
So there were no draws. Someone always
No such thing.
Okay, cool.
The board is designed so it's mathematically impossible to do that.
That would be really somebody boring game show if they ended in a draw.
Well, lots of games do have draws.
Yeah.
But this one is cleverly designed.
Cool.
It's a best 2 out of 3 match. Whoever wins that goes on to what's called the gold run. And this is a similar board of hexagons, except instead of single letters in the hexagons, it can be a series of letters. So let's say, for example, WWTBAM, and you describe game show hosted by Regis Philbin, and they might say, "You want to be a millionaire."
Yeah.
You get those, and that hexagon turns gold, and you're trying to do a connection from left to right. However, if you get one wrong in that, it goes black, and that's a block, and you have to work your way around it.
Okay.
You get 60 seconds, and if you can complete from left to right, you win $5,000.
That sounds like a fun game. This is a game that I vaguely remember coming on, like, during USA.
USA did lots of reruns of it.
Yeah, it would come on, like, right before, like, Scrabble or something like that.
I don't really remember it at all.
Yeah, and it wasn't a game that I was never, like, rushing to see it, but it came on before one of the shows that I did like. So I'd catch, like, the end of it from time to time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was a fun show, but, you know, it was never, like, my favorite. But it is a cool concept about how you can block somebody and they have to make their way around to get to the other side.
The original show was hosted by the incomparable Bill Cullen. His name will come up quite a bit.
Yep.
It lasted for a few years, went away for a few years, came back for a very short run with Bill Rafferty, who did that syndicated Card Sharks that I never saw.
Yeah, I remember that name.
And that one was just one player against one player.
Oh, one-on-one, huh? Okay.
Even though the board itself stayed the same, except if you won each one won a game out of the 2 out of 3 match. Then they would do a 4x4 grid, which really doesn't work with hexagons. It still leaves one side with a bit of an advantage because there are more connective points.
Yeah.
But they ignored that and just played that way.
So what was there some sort of handicap for the one player
Well, that's the thing. One player
can 4 and 5. Okay.
Only
okay.
4.
Gotcha.
Whereas
gotcha.
2 have to get 5.
Now, okay, that makes sense to me. Because I'm like, well, why wouldn't you always want to have another person to consult with? Could you consult with each other? I assume you could.
Not verbally back and forth.
Okay.
But
so if you buzzed in, you had to answer without the help of your partner?
Exactly right.
Okay, okay. All right, so that is a little bit more of a challenge, I guess. Cool. It's pretty fun.
You just have 2 brands working for you instead of the 1.
So, Nick, does this ring a bell to you whatsoever?
No, no, I don't really remember it at all.
Okay. Well, like I said, I've seen it not many times, though. So I'm sorry, Mark, I can't really speak to it.
I don't expect you to. This is, and I admit that several of mine are going to be more obscure now.
I like that, though. I like that we have some obscure stuff. That's usually Nick's job.
Blockbuster started in the U.S., but combined, I think maybe had only 4 years, maybe not even that,
okay.
run, and hasn't been seen since. In the U.K., it ran, and it was more for college students. But otherwise, the rules were very, very similar. It ran for years and years.
Did it have a catchy theme?
I love the theme to both versions of Blockbusters, well, actually.
The only reason I ask that is because the only thing I do kind of remember about it is I think I've seen the name. I've got a CD somewhere of like game show
themes. I'm going to be playing each game show theme at some point. During the reveal of this, each game show.
I just feel like...
You guys are going to get to hear that.
Yeah, I just feel like I've seen, the name of it just, on a CD or something.
The original Blockbusters theme is one of my favorites.
Cool. I would ask you to hum it, but we're going to have it, so you don't have to.
I'm assuming.
Okay. All right. So I guess we'll move on to Nick's number 2, if you don't mind, sir.
All right. Press your luck.
Today, these 3 players are after big bucks, but they'll have to avoid the whammy as they play the most exciting game of their lives. From Television City in Hollywood, it's time to press your luck. And now, here's your host, the star of Press Your Luck, Peter Tamarkin.
Thank you. Thank you. My thanks to the one and only Rod Roddy, and welcome to Press Your Luck, the most competitive game in television.
Oh, press your luck with the whammies.
Big money, no whammies. Stop.
Stop.
Yes. Now, and they would dance across the screen if you got a whammy.
Yeah, I love the whammy. And that's the absolute reason why I love Press Your Luck. It's just because of the whammies.
I'm sorry, Nick. This is your show. You reminisce.
Well,
rooting for people to fail.
I have no idea how the game is even played. I just remember the whammies. Oh, and I remember the infamous story of the guy that memorized the pattern.
Michael Larson.
Of the board.
Mark knows his name.
Yeah,
that's awesome. That's why I love having Mark.
A couple of days ago, in fact.
Yeah.
Okay, let's start with the rules.
Okay.
It's a board of, I want to say, 20 illuminated squares.
Yeah.
Each one has a dollar amount,
yep.
a prize,
yep.
or a whammy.
Or possibly a whammy. And they would just flash randomly.
Well, it's random.
Right, right.
You start out, first round, they ask you some questions. It's all, it's not multiple choice. It starts out open-ended, and if you buzz in and know the answer and get it right, uh-huh. you will win 3 spins. But whatever you've answered, right or wrong, will be added to 2 to make it a multiple choice thing where the other 2 contestants get a chance to guess.
Uh-huh.
And if they get it right, they get a spin apiece.
Gotcha.
So after 4 questions, that set of spins, however much was earned, is played on a fairly low-budget board. And they'll accumulate whatever totals they do, whatever whammies they do. Because if you hit a whammy, you lose everything you've earned up to that point.
Yeah, and didn't the little whammies show up on the podium?
There'd be little cartoons.
Well, there was a little card that would show up after.
Yeah, it was a little physical card.
Oh, yeah. I don't know.
Okay.
So the idea is you want to have the highest total at the end of the first spinning round, because that will allow you to play last in the final round, and that gives you an advantage. Mm-hmm. But you have to play all of your spins, however much you earned in the question round,
gotcha,
until and unless you decide to pass all of your spins.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So you play as long as you feel like you dare, pressing your luck each time, because again, every time you spin, the whammy could take it all away.
Yep.
And that once you've decided you've had enough, you have to pass whatever spins you have left to whoever has the highest total of your opponents. And then they spin, and they have to take all of the spins that are passed to them. They do not even have the chance
to pass. It's
like
Uno, when you like play the card where they have to draw the other cards.
So the guy that memorized the pattern, he just never passed.
Let's get to him. Michael Morrison.
I want to hear this story. I vaguely remember.
Michael Morrison was something of a ne'er-do-well.
A person without a means of support, an idle, worthless person, a loafer, a person who is ineffectual.
He was always trying to figure out ways to cheat the system. Now, when it came to game show Press Your Luck, he discovered fairly early on, with the use of a videotape recorder and the pause button,
VCRs,
that the patterns were not random, but that there were, I think it was just 5 possible patterns where the lights would go in a very predictable way, uh-huh, across the board. And there are 2 squares that never, ever have whammies in them. One is the big square at the top middle of the board that has either $3,000, $4,000, or $5,000 and a spin.
So even if your timing was off, you wouldn't even get a whammy.
Oh, wow.
If you landed on that square.
Well, he's going for that square, though.
That's the thing. He might not be able to predict if it's going to be the $3,000, the $4,000, or the $5,000, but he can predict exactly that he's going to land on that space.
Yeah, it wasn't so fast that you couldn't hit it and land on it and stay there. You just didn't know what you were getting. So that's interesting. I didn't know that. That's how he beat it.
Well, yeah, but you know, the idea is nobody else before him had even recognized that the lights were going in a pattern that could be predicted.
Yeah, because I remember,
so he would
like,
say,
the guys
one,
running
four,
the show
two,
are like,
three, it'll be on this one next. Hit stop, and it'll be there.
$26,086, and you still have 6 spins, and he's going. Michael's going with $26,000. Unbelievable. What's happening? Stop at 750 and a spin. You can't get rid of spins, Michael. That's 48,351. That must be at least 15 spins. 4,000 and a spin. 74,851. Michael, you have rolled 31 times without a whammy. 31 times. You're going to press again? Oh.
Did they really make, did they come to that realization like mid-show?
I remember reading an article about it, but maybe I should just let
So he's continue. Playing the show. He doesn't really do much in the first round, because the first round doesn't matter all that much.
Okay.
Except, again, if you have the most, you can be the last to spin. But he didn't care about that. He actually was dead last at the end of the first round. Round 2, however, he starts playing. He's got, I think it was 7 spins. And after a false start or two, starts nailing that 5,000 at a spin, or at least that square, because again, it could be 3,000, could be 4,000,
right,
every single time.
That's amazing.
Producers are backstage freaking out.
Like, what is going on?
Because they never imagined this was even possible.
Oh my gosh. I love hearing these kinds of stories. So
they
much.
Had to split that show up into 2 episodes because they couldn't edit it in such a way as to fit everything into the regular half hour.
Oh my God.
So at the end of just a few spins, Larson's already in the 5-digit figures, screen freezes, and a superimposed Peter Tomarkin comes on screen to say,
"Well, I want to tell you, you are watching Press Your Luck history in the making. We are going to have to stop now for these messages."
Superimposed, that's awesome. So
by the end of it all, Larson had over $110,000 accumulated. Now, you got to understand, any contestant who ever gets over $25,000 immediately has to retire, but they still get to keep everything they've earned.
Okay.
So
that was a rule in the show.
He gets to win all that $110,000+. And although the producers are trying to figure out in a way accusing him of cheating,
uh-huh,
turns out he didn't actually break any of the rules. He just exploited a failure in the system itself.
Yeah, I remember reading that, because it's not, he didn't really cheat. Right. Nobody said you couldn't memorize the pattern that nobody knew was there.
So he there was so okay. Did he write a book or something? Like why would he even admit it?
Here's the thing. I told you he was a ne'er-do-well. He lost all that money inside of 2 years through bad real estate investments. He ended up getting involved in some shady deals that put him on the run from the government. The FBI wanted him. He died in poverty.
Oh, wow. That's crazy. But
7 years later, there was a new version that came out called Whammy, the all-new Press Your Luck, which actually did have a random board. And so as part of a gimmick, Peter Tarkin was still alive at this time. They brought back the two contestants that Bill Larson beat, and also Bill Larson's brother. Turned out the brother still won.
Well, he's just lucky, I guess.
Hey, let me ask you this. Now, okay, you know, because everybody says, like, the same thing. Big money, no whammy, stop.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Where did that come from? Is that, like, something that, like, the first person said, and then it just kind of caught on? Or is that something they kind of tell you, this is what we do here?
Yeah, the producers are like, okay, this is what we do.
My guess, and I don't know this for a fact, my guess is it's a combination of the two. Because the first few episodes, it's not that consistent. And, in fact, they don't always even say stop when they hit the buzzer.
Yeah.
But contestant coordinators, in general, really like to amp up contestants and tell them to, you know, be all vivid and excited and stuff.
Oh yeah.
And
well, they do it in television shows with applause, you know, like they whip up the crowd. So, you know,
exactly right. So my guess is that did develop where somebody started saying that and somebody decided that's really good, let's encourage people to do that.
Yeah.
And so by the time the show had been around for a while, yes, everyone was
doing
it.
That's just what you do.
Yeah, you just, you know, it didn't work unless you said it. It didn't stop. Well, you didn't say.
I should actually mention, I have tried out for a number of game shows.
Okay. I was wondering if you were going to bring this up.
I did audition for Pyramid at one point. I did audition for Whammy when the all-new Press Your Luck came back. I've never actually made it onto a show.
Yeah.
And I've got theories about why that is, but what I can tell you about Whammy, during the audition, they put us in front of one of those little metal bells that you go ding at a counter,
mm-hmm.
and encouraged us to act like that was the Whammy buzzer and how we would act.
Okay.
You know, what kind of stuff we would say. Now, I don't know how well I would have been, other things being equal, but I looked at that little metal bell, you know, it's got a kind of thin point at the top.
Yeah, everybody's seen that thing. Yeah.
And I'm thinking, if I hit that too hard, I'm gonna hurt my hand. It's not like a real buzzer, which is totally flat at the top.
Yeah, right. Slam down on it.
Yeah, you're gonna like hurt your. Yeah, exactly.
So I'm sure I choked it, quite honestly. I don't remember specifically, but I remember being conscious of the fact that this is a metal bell that's not even all the way across.
It just kind of gingerly go down on it.
I mean, I probably still played up the verbal part as much as I could.
Yeah.
That probably looked completely fake, but nonetheless.
Well,
so that was my Whammy audition experience anyway.
That's showbiz, I guess. Mm. You're right. I mean, it's you there's a certain thing they're looking for, I guess, certain qualities, you know. I don't know.
Quite honestly, I'm not sure if I will ever get on one. I think I'll still keep trying as good opportunities come around.
Yeah.
But
well, where is Price is Right?
Quiet for the most part until you really get them talking.
Well, where's the Price is Right filmed? Are you near that? Where can you go on?
But it's in LA.
Yeah.
I've been to a lot of Price is Right tapings, and anytime you go to a Price is Right taping, you're a potential contestant.
Right, right.
I've been there for Bob Barker. I've been there for Drew Carey.
Nice. That's cool. I would really enjoy going to a taping of The Price is Right, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Of any show.
You do, really. You can actually get tickets in advance nowadays. It's not just a matter of waiting in line.
Oh, okay. Cool. It sounds like maybe if I ever come out there, I'll check it out. Okay. You know, so Press Your Luck, you think of anything else? Was there more than one host, or was it just the one host all the time?
The host of the original Press Your Luck, which itself was a remake of a show called Second Chance that nobody remembers.
Yeah,
Second Chance was hosted by a guy named Jim Peck. The board was static, essentially. The lights all moved around, but the dollar amounts and prizes did not.
Okay.
anyway, Press Your Luck was hosted by Peter Tamarkin, and then Whammy, when the Game Show Network new version came up, was hosted by a guy named Todd Newton, except that Peter Tamarkin did come back for a question segment on that one that brought back Larson's competitors.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's an all-time classic. And for when Nick and I at our age, I guess, and you too, Mark, you're not like super much, you're not just a year or two older than us. The big draw for that was always the cartoons. Fun thing, you know. They Absolutely. Would moonwalk and, you know, do their little dance, and then boing, you know, the little thing would come
Lots
up.
Lots of pop culture references.
Yeah, so it was a good time, and yeah. You know, that instantly pops up. Like, that's one of those ones that, like, I'm sure all three of us considered, and one of us just called it. You know, like I got it. Anything else about Press Your Luck? Move on to my number two. Now, my number two is one that I remember very fondly, and it's Hollywood Squares.
From her hit Broadway show, Joan Rivers. From his HBO series, First Contend, John Mulroney. From the Broadway stage, Anthony Newley. From the Northwest corner, Jim J. Bullock. From his video, Sweating to the Oldies, Richard Simmons. From professional baseball, Gold Glove winner, Steve Garvey. From TV's Young and the Restless, Tom Beers. From the comedy stage, Jimmy Walker. And me, I'm Shadow Stevens. We are the new Hollywood Squares. And here's our tour guide, John Emerson. Thank you, tour guide. Thank you, Shadow.
Okay, the John Davison version then.
And that's the... Okay, I gotta admit, I have a confession. I did not know that there was an other version before him. I knew of the version after John Davison, but I didn't know the one before.
Yes.
It ran for many years. And talk about mind-blowing. Boom! Like, I did not know that at all. And it's like the same thing. It's like the, you know, the boxes that they climb up into.
You know what always got me excited when Hollywood Squares would come on?
I think I know what you're going to say.
If Alf was ever yes. contested.
When Alf was the center square, I went nuts. And that's why I want to say that, like, E.T. was like a companion to it. Because, like, they would kind of preview who was going to be on the show.
Yeah.
So I feel like, and I may be remembering this totally incorrectly, but I feel like
it wasn't intentional, but it worked out that way in our era because yeah. they were both in syndication and one aired right after the other.
Right. Okay. So, yeah. So that was the case.
And Jim J. Bullock was like,
Jim J. Bullock was like, every time, always in the center. But I'll attempt to explain Hollywood Squares since Mark's been doing such a phenomenal job for us on most of these shows. And then Mark,
the original version started in 1966, hosted by Peter Marshall, went through 1981.
I'm not gonna attempt it.
I guess not. Go ahead, Mark. Okay, he's stopping. Are you stopping right there for me?
Center square for most of that run was a guy named Paul Lind, who was extremely well known through a bunch of shows of that era, Bewitched. You might remember him as the voice of Templeton the Rat in the animated Charlotte's Web.
Oh, okay.
Very snarky, the wisecracking persona, perfect for the center square of this show.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yeah, the center square had to be like kind of the best at quippies, like making quips. Because part of the show was, you know, you would... They would ask a question, but then the celebrities would always try to make a joke out of it. Like, you never accepted the first answer gave.
G.I. Joe, Robin, is a manly doll for sure. After all, the term G.I. means he's a fighting man, but what did G.I. originally stand for?
If we're talking about the doll, we're talking about genitally impaired.
Quite right.
It was always sort of a throwaway thing they would say. No one ever just went right to the answer.
And the format is basically, you know, they ask that question, the celebrity gives their answer whenever the serious answer finally comes
right.
out. And the contestant has to either agree or disagree with that answer. If they do so correctly, they get their X or that O.
Mm-hmm. It's tic-tac-toe.
But if they fail, they give that X or the O, whichever the opponent has, and they get that square for free.
Oh, they didn't even have to answer the question?
Nope.
I don't remember but, that.
Well, it's an agree or disagree, so it's a binary.
Okay. Right. Okay, okay. Gotcha. Wow. Oh, that's
but
interesting.
But you couldn't win off of somebody getting a wrong answer.
Hmm.
So okay. If you had three in a row and that changing to X, for example, would give you that three in a row, the O missing it doesn't change anything. It just leaves that blank.
Because you have to say it that one for the win. Yeah. And I always felt, I genuinely felt like the celebrities felt so bad for the contestants when they would, like, you know, get it wrong and then they would agree or disagree. I guess they were coached not to lead on that they didn't really know the answer or not. I mean, that would make sense. It would be a disadvantage if they were, if there was any sort of, they always had to give the answer kind of somewhat confidently.
Hollywood Squares was a little unusual in that this was a show where celebrities were provided with their questions in advance. And it was perfectly legitimate. It wasn't breaking, you know, the rules on, you know, rigging games and such.
Okay.
Because it enabled them then to craft their joke responses a lot of times.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I gotcha. How far in advance did they get them?
No, I have no idea on that. It could be as little as half an hour before the show. It could be a week before. No idea.
Gotcha.
But there's a little disclaimer that would show up on the screen that would say some celebrities were provided questions in advance, but it didn't mean such and such. You know, they have to do those disclaimers in order to appease the government.
Well, yeah, because some celebrities are just generally made for that type of response. And then others, you know, they may be a celebrity, but, you know, they're not an entertainer necessarily. They're just known. Like, they could be like Bob Ross could be on like Hollywood Squares.
Gilbert Gottfried was often a contestant on these things. Usually lower level celebrities, not necessarily your A-listers.
Correct. But yeah, they were never Gottfried, like your Tom Cruise or anything like that.
Almost always gave an incorrect answer. And if the contestant agreed with him, he would do, and I'm not going to try to imitate his voice, can't do the duck quite well enough, but, "You fool! You fool!"
I'm going to say food.
I'll disagree.
Food. All right, now here.
Having a child.
I disagree.
You fool! having a child. This is rowing the Atlantic.
I'm going to agree.
You fool!
She went around the world.
Boy.
I agree.
You fool! Okay, it's the last perfect pitch game.
I'm gonna agree.
You fool!
Yeah, I remember that. That's awesome. But yeah, that, you know, it's another one of those shows. It's very simple, basic. Everybody's played tic-tac-toe. And yeah. I mean, that concept shows up quite a number of times, I guess, in game shows. Mm-hmm. But it was, I loved the fact that, you know, I always enjoyed game shows with celebrities. It was fun, you know?
Yeah, the intro was always real cool, you know, because it would introduce like each celebrity that's going to be on it that day, you know, Whoopi Goldberg. And, you know, it was always like in the center square.
Yeah, it was like a big deal. And I remember the first time I ever saw like the stage, like profile view, you know, like from the side, it blew my mind. It was real weird. Like you always just saw them. Yeah. You didn't know how long that box was or how big it was. You just, cause you always had that front facing
every once in a while. Like if it would like cut to a commercial or something, it'd show like that different angle.
Yeah. So I'm thinking in my head, I'm like, wow, those celebrities could have been in danger. You never know. I mean, there could have been an accident with
some celebrities.
Sometimes,
you know, they would like climb down to like another one or whatever, like to interact or something.
That's true. Or like right from one to the next.
They're like, get back up in your square.
Yeah. The celebrities really seem to have a lot of fun with the show. And it showed in the show. And I really enjoy that show. Mark, do you have any interesting tidbits for Hollywood Squares?
One footnote that Hollywood Squares shares in common with Match Game is that it was the subject of an experiment in the mid-80s after the original version with Peter Marshall was gone, but before the John Davidson version started. There was a hybrid show called the Match Game Hollywood Squares Hour. Lasted all of one season. the Hollywood Squares portion was hosted by a guy named John Bowman, who had at that time been most well known as the lead singer Bowser in a group called Sha Na Na. It was kind of a retro 50s thing. Was not a terribly good host. Gene Rayburn, who hosted the Match Game segment, absolutely hated him. Hollywood Squares portion was not run particularly well. They were all multiple choice questions instead of open-ended. You actually could win a game just by having your opponent give an incorrect answer. It failed on a lot of important levels. I don't think that Mark Goodson, who was the producer of that version, really understood what made Hollywood Squares, which was a property from somebody else, it didn't understand what it made it work. Because it was owned by another group, it's never been rerun, ever. There are rights concerns with Match Game being owned by one entity and Hollywood Squares being owned by somebody else, and it's just been very complicated.
Yeah, sometimes you just lose things because of copyrights and all those types of things. They're just gone forever. Hollywood Squares, I do believe, is something that's ripe for a reboot. I feel like that's a show.
Oh, yeah.
There are so many C and D level grade celebrities these days due to social media, even. I mean, they could collect these people, no problem. So I would like to see it come back. I think the last year it ran was like mid 2000s or something like that. So
I don't even know if it was that long ago. The guy who does Dancing with the Stars, I'm blanking.
Tom Bergeron or something like that.
Tom Bergeron.
Yeah, Bergeron. There you go.
He hosted the most recent version. It went for a good number of years.
Well, I have it written down, and it could be incorrect. 98 to 2004.
I feel like
this book I have will not have that because it doesn't have the later 2000s at all. But
gotcha.
I feel like we always watched, and I don't remember the order, which was first, which was second, but Hollywood Squares and Funniest Home Videos, like back.
Oh before. Yeah,
yeah, they have a similar quality to them, I suppose.
Let us first take a second. I want to challenge Mark. I'm not going to challenge him. I'm gonna judge Mark. Funniest Home Videos, is it a game show?
That goes very much into what I was talking about earlier. I would actually say no.
Okay.
There is a prize involved. I get that. But the focus of the show is not really a game. It's a contest. You send in your videos, semantics, and then you have no further involvement until the videos are chosen.
He makes valid points.
Yeah.
But my gut was first saying yes.
Mine too, just because that's there was fine. A prize like that. That was my kind of, you know,
and that's a perfectly legitimate descriptor.
Yeah.
And you know, when I was saying my like description, like if I was going to tell Logan like what a game show was,
mm-hmm.
and like the first thing I said was you have contestants.
Yeah. It's a big part of the show. Yeah.
Submitting a video isn't quite the same as being a contestant so much, I don't think.
Not
and
really.
You never even see the people unless they happen to be in that top two or three, and that's not even true for all episodes.
Yeah, because it's only then that, you know, that's like the winner or whatever.
I guess they would invite the finalists, I guess, is how they would do it.
That seems to have been the case, at least back in Bob Saget's era. I don't know how long they continued that on. I don't know if they're still doing it with Alfonso Rivera.
I think it could be totally argued no, but yeah, my gut at first was yes.
But that's an extremely long-running and successful show, and it's cheap to do, so ABC keeps doing it.
Oh, yeah, and well, now everybody's got a camera. Like, back in the Bob Saget days, video cameras were a bit more of a luxury, as we've mentioned before in the past. But now everyone could potentially send in. I can't even imagine the candidates that they get. They have to screen all the videos. And I don't want to get off on too much on America's Funniest Home Videos, but I always hated the ones that seemed obviously staged.
Yeah.
I hated it. But not everyone can look like a legitimate shot to the groin either. So, which was their bread and butter. If I ever saw a bat, if a dad wasn't even in the picture, I knew he was going to lumber in at some point. Like, oh, there's a kid with a bat and here's dad. But it was entertaining. I have to admit, I enjoyed the show.
Sure.
Okay, so that takes us back around to you, Mark. For your number
three. All right, my number three, Tic-Tac-Doe.
From Hollywood,
It's everybody's game of strategy, knowledge, and fun. It's tic-tac-toe. And now, here's our host, Wing Martindale.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Hollywood Squares without the celebrities.
Exactly.
Right. So this is also a tic-tac-toe game, except in this case, the nine squares are categories. And you would choose which category you would have a question asked. You know, so famous celebrities, you'd say ask a question about a celebrity, see if you can name it.
Is this
if you get it right, you get your X.
Yes, it is.
And
I love the dragon.
You add a certain amount of money to the pot. So for the era I'm most familiar with, which was Wink Martindale, it was $200 for the perimeter squares and $300 for the center square. The center square was always a two-part question. So a little bit harder, a little bit more money. And of course, it's a strategic place in the board.
Mark, let me just have you pause for 1 second. This theme has been playing in my head ever since we started the episode, and I'm wondering if this is the show that used it. When you would ask a contestant a question and they'd have a moment to think, is this the one where it would go, wow, wow.
That's it.
Wow. Yes! Yes! Totally nailed it.
Man, and you were talking about like the sets and stuff before.
Yeah.
I love this set, man.
Yeah,
it was
yeah.
Like, so was it 70s?
Oh, yeah.
So 70s.
It started in the late 70s. At least the version we know was late 70s. This is a show that actually started back in 56.
Well, because I was afraid I was going to say, it was so 70s. And he'll be like, well, it was actually
Well, actually, 60s. It began in the 30s.
Well, here's the deal. The original version, black and white, 1950s, all that, was one of those original rigged shows that Jack Barry Enright and Dan Enright put together. And so Jack Barry left TV entirely in disgrace for a number of years. Tic-Tac-Doe was when his company, Barry Enright Productions, was only just getting back. Mm. And so they brought it back with Wink Martindale, changed the pot a bit. That's where all the set that you know comes from. Let me see if I can get a date on this. It was 1978, it premiered on CBS and then came in syndication later that same year. It lasted in syndication far longer. It didn't last on CBS hardly at all.
Can we talk about the dragon?
Oh, the dragon.
Behind number two, what do we find? The dragon.
You were doing a very excellent description of the show, and Nick and I made contact, and we're just like, I love the dragon. He was awesome because it was on a video, you know. And
it was like a TV screen or something.
Uh-huh.
Pop up.
All right. So
why would the dragon pop up?
I don't know. I don't know what dragons and tic-tac-toe have anything to do with one another. Why not? I guess right. Could have been a gorilla for all I care.
Mark knows. Hush and listen to Mark.
Oh, teach us, Mark.
If you won your game, got your tic-tac-toe three in a row, you go to play the bonus round, which is called Face the Dragon.
Mm.
And each of your nine squares, you know, they're each independently operated computers, basically, numbered 1 through 9 on the board. And they hide various money amounts, ranging from 100 to 500. There are two spaces, one of which says tick, one says tack. You get those two as a pair, then you automatically win. If you get money amounts that add up to 1,000 or more, you win. If you find the dragon, you lose.
Right.
Now, this was a feature of a lot of Barry Enright games where there was some icon, in this case, a dragon, but it was always, you know, something evil, bad, sinister, that if you found it,
a
then,
devil, a dragon, yeah,
then you lose your money and you don't win anything in the bonus round. But if you did get to $1,000 or if you found both tick and tack, you would win that money plus a prize package that was usually in the $3,000 to $4,000 range, which in the late 70s, early 80s, fairly substantial.
That's substantial for sure. Mm-hmm. Cool. So the dragon was just part of the final challenge, basically, the bonus round or whatever you call
and
it.
And it got to be really, really popular. So that by the later part of Wink Martindale's run, if a contestant won, they would still go to the audience and pick out random audience members to say, okay, one of those remaining squares, which one do you think the dragon's hiding under? They call it the Dragon Finder.
I didn't know that.
And they were playing until they found the dragon.
I kind of remember that, I think.
I don't remember that at all. So everybody loves seeing that dragon, I guess. It's kind of like the whammy of its day. I remember the dragon, but when we were talking about our list, I went back to YouTube and watched an episode to kind of refresh my memory a little bit about the show. Mm-hmm. And the instant I saw the dragon, I was like, oh, yeah, I forget. I love the dragon. The dragon was the best. Everything else about the show is fun, and it's essentially, it's just tic-tac-toe.
I think every one of these shows, there was like just like some standout thing for me that I loved. And yeah. Then I'm like, I don't even know.
Oh, that's fine. Remember, I mean,
I was talking about Blockbusters, how you couldn't actually end that game in a tie. Well, tic-tac-toe, of course, you can. Hmm. The cat's game, so to speak.
Right.
The way they handled that in Wink Martindale's version, because I said they had this running pot of money that you kept adding money to, is they would just leave that alone, wipe the board clean, come up with a new set of 9 categories, and keep playing until there's a winner. So those pots could get pretty large. Mm-hmm. This is where I have to talk about the 1990 version of Tic-Tac-Toe.
Which you
love. As you can tell, it's awful. The easiest game show host in history. He was painful to watch.
Who is this again?
Patrick Wayne, John Wayne's son. Loved game shows, should never have been allowed to host one.
Okay. I'll have to try and look that up.
Had theme music that was done by the guy who did the Pink Panther theme. Unfortunately, it was not up to his usual standards. It was a terrible sounding theme.
I love that theme.
The regular game, if you actually ended in a tie, they would wipe the pot clean and say that the next round was worth double the money. So they would start a new pot where now the values were twice as much. But the trick to that is it makes it impossible for that game to be won for this, even as much money as the other one would have been if you'd left that money there, even with double the pot. The most you could possibly do is hope to get where you would have been in terms of value. So they're clearly trying to save money here. Yeah. Cut rate thing. The board was all computer generated. It looked cheap. It was awful. Oh, man. They did, however, keep the dragon around for the bonus round. But even that was tainted.
Don't do, can't do, won't do. If you do, you'll be through.
That was what I was gonna say. But was at least the dragon cool?
Yeah.
The dragon was not cool. The dragon was now in a different kind of board with X's and O's that you were hoping to maybe find a string of 3 in a row. Or, instead of Tick and Tack, they had what was called the Dragon Slayer as like a knight in shining armor character. And before every bonus round, they would introduce the dragon and the Dragon Slayer, each with his own cheesy rap.
Oh, no! I was going to joke and say, did the dragon have a backwards baseball cap on?
No, he would come up with some ridiculous rhyme about who he is and what he does. And this was the 90s, so let's wrap it.
Oh, man.
It was terrible.
I'm cringing thinking about it right now. Why did everything have to cheesy white guy rap back then? Even the dragon. Leave the dragon alone. Yep. Oh, Mark, that's disappointing. I could have gone on without knowing that. All right. Well,
there has never been another version of Tic-Tac-Toe to this day. 1990-91 killed it.
Another dead show. And, you know, you would think that it would be a cheap show to produce. Bring it back. And then I guess they'll have like a CG dragon or something nowadays. Voiced by Eddie Murphy.
Couldn't look as bad as that one.
What's that, Mark? I'm sorry.
Couldn't possibly look as bad as the CGI set of the 90s Tic-Tac-Toe.
Yeah, they tend to do like the game shows nowadays like pretty extravagantly. They don't cheap it out. Yeah. Okay. Well, Nick, you know what? I'm looking at the time, and this has been going on for a bit. I think I'm going to call it right here, and we're going to just call this part one of the episode. And we'll return next week with the conclusion of our list. So we're about midway through.
Okay.
So does that seem okay with you, Mark?
So I get to start?
You'll get to start in the next episode.
Okay.
All right, everybody. Well, Marky, thanks for showing. Thanks for joining us for this episode.
Always.
This is tailor-made for you, honestly. I had written down in my show like notes for shows that I want to do in the future. And that's when I kind of got the idea, because I wanted to do a board game episode. And then I was like, game shows. So like I instantly penciled you in without even really knowing for sure if you'd want to do it. It's like a TV game show episode with Mark.
Oh, yeah, because I think you asked me if he would like to. And yeah. I was like, he would love that.
Yeah. Well, you're a great guest, Mark. I really appreciate you, buddy.
Thank you.
For this week, I've been your host, Ron Avis.
And I'm Nick Wright.
And I'm Mark Baker-Wright.
And we'll see you next week.
See ya.